prelude, I'm going to play Why Me, Lord? It's a Chris Christopherson song, and I'm going to paraphrase. What he's doing is he's asking how he is blessed with what God has given us, because he doesn't think he deserves that. And then he's asking what he can do to repay the Lord for what he's done for him. And in the chorus, it says that, Dear Jesus, help me, because my soul is in your hands. And so as I'm playing that, I'd kind of like you to think about those words and kind of where you're at with the Lord, and if you're blessing him every day or thanking him every day for your blessings.
Christopherson wrote that, and it was right after he went to church and felt God's presence, and that's the reason he wrote that song. You might even have said some of that. Probably did. Oh, okay. Well, you bet. It's amazing what you can learn on when you watch PBS. And but anyway. Well, it's a blessing to have you here. My name is Dennis Carter. I'm pastor here at Ellsworth Methodist Church and also Knopless Methodist Church. And it's just always a joy to be in God's presence and God's house. And I pray that each and every one of you feel God's presence and love embraces you. And what a blessing that is. At this time, we have announcements. And if you have announcements, hold up your hand and they'll bring a mic to you.
Bulletin is the announcement for our Freedom Night. It's kind of our encounter evening. It's this coming Saturday, so 6 days out, 6 o'clock in the evening here in our sanctuary till about 8. So we'll have a session, we'll have a cookie break, and then we'll have another session. And as much as I can possibly strong arm you into coming, I hope you will come and join us, because I just think it will be that good. It did not start out with a theme, and I don't know that it has an official theme, but there are several connections with the Salina Rescue Mission, And part of that's a story I'll share a little bit on Saturday evening. One of our speakers is Chris Coleman, and Chris is the operations manager of the mission. He and Chad Young, who many of you are familiar with, work together. So it's a great team. So you'll just get to hear another part of the team for the rescue mission. One of the testimonies is coming from the mission. So with that in mind, it's kind of a last minute thought, but we will have an offering plate out there that evening if you would like to make a monetary donation. If you want to bring a sack of groceries that can go to the kitchen, they'll take that. If some of you guys have some used clothing that's still good that you have just not worn or outgrown or undergrown, that doesn't happen at my house, but towels, good used towels, single bed bedding, all of those types of things, toiletries can always be used. So we'll have some boxes in the back and we'll send those. Or I will take them on another trip when I go over. But please come and join us. Please bring a friend. You will be blessed.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any other announcements? I think Alice has one.
Okay, Ken said this Saturday, I'm going to say mark your calendars for a year from this Saturday. For the next women's retreat. Pat and Joni Law and myself were absolutely overwhelmed with the wonderful, wonderful Manhattan Christian College sponsored women's retreat. It was called Devoted, and their scripture that they used was they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. And absolutely all of the workshops centered around that scripture and how we as Christians are to reach out and grow. The Christian life should not be one of standing still. It should always be moving. And the way that our nation is going to change is through the church. And it's very important that believers continue to grow and to learn and to reach out to others. So get corner any of us, and we will be glad to share some of the really great insights that we had. It was amazing. There were girls and women everywhere from 8 years old to in their 90s there. Over 400 women. So it was an amazing thing. And if you know that this is not something that you could do, but you'd like to be helping, we would love to be able to offer scholarships. So that people, especially young moms, would be able to get away and it would not cost anything. So, again, let us know about that. But a year, always the last weekend in February. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sounds like it was a wonderful time.
Thank you guys again for your support with the youth group, with the meals and the prayers that you've given to us as a group. I did not explain it well enough, or I hadn't explained it for a while. At the back foyer on the sidewall on the south end, there are profile cards for the youth that they put some information about themselves. If you want to take one or two, take one down or two down and just take it, read it, and then get to know a little bit about some of these kids that come on Wednesday night. And then all you need to do is pray for them. That's the main thing, prayer cards and just to get to know them a little bit. And if you want to do a little bit more, Pat had asked, like, what could we do? If you wanted to leave a card for that student, just leave it downstairs with their name on it, and then on Wednesday night they will have it. If you want to put like a little tiny bag of M&Ms, I'm sure they'd appreciate it. But the main thing is just to pray for them, get to know them, and I'm trying to find a way where they also could maybe, partner with you so that they could pray for you as well. And then one more thing with the youth, we've decided that we're going to go at the end of the year, at the end of the school year, we're going to Kansas City with them. We're going to do a day of missions work and then a day of fellowship, and hopefully on a Sunday go to one of the bigger churches there so that they could see a different, setting. So hopefully that's going to be good. And then we're going to do a fundraiser at the end of April. All right? Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any others you'd like to share? Okay.
On my nephew, we did a video chat with the doctor this last week, and they will start chemo on Tuesday. He'll have chemo for 4 days, and then on the fifth day get bags of IVs of anti-nausea, and I'm not sure what all, but anyway. And then he'll do that every 3 weeks. So it will definitely be a journey. So keep him in your prayers.
Yeah,
thank
keep
you.
Keep Ryan, Linda's nephew, in your thoughts and prayers. I had the opportunity, I am back, had the opportunity to go to prison for only a couple of days, and for Brothers in Blue, had 39 baptisms, first time baptisms, had about 12 also reaffirmation of faith and wanted to be baptized again. It's just a real blessing, and it's always a blessing to be able to go out there and share about God's grace and about God's love, especially about God's forgiveness. And it was just a wonderful time. And we'll be going out again in October. Plus, had the opportunity to go out every Wednesday for Bible study. Last week there was 18, and I wouldn't be surprised if there won't be double this next Wednesday. So, anyway, had the opportunity to go out with Exe Barber, and we do a Bible study on Wednesdays, and it's just great. Okay. Are there any others? Are there any others? Well, if not, let us center ourselves, and then we'll greet one another. The team recognition was last month. We'll do it again, last week. We'll do it again, different teams. We'll be doing that every month through April, and it's just a blessing to get to know who's on the teams, so we can pray for them, and also so you're familiar with them and you can talk to them, or one of maybe they can empower you to do some things that they're doing, and that'll be a real blessing. So let us go to the Lord. Gracious God, I just come before you today. There's been joys of a weekend's trips, and either in Manhattan or at ECF, dear Lord, for the opportunity for next week and for the Freedom Night. And I just thank you for that. Dear Lord, we want to lift up Linda's nephew, Ryan. I also want to lift up Linda and Scott Davis and continue to minister to them. Dear Lord, for those that are going through treatments, dear Lord, we just lift them up to you. For those that are just need to feel your presence, you know exactly what's going on in their lives, and we just thank you again. It's just a blessing to center ourselves and reflect on your love and grace. In Jesus' precious name, amen. So at this time, let us greet one another, if you would please.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
If you'll join me in the call to worship that's in your bulletin, but also up on the screen. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare.
Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but my ears have opened.
Burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not require.
And then I said, here I am, I have come, it is written about me in this world. I desire to do your will, my God, your law.
Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we thank you again for your love, for your word. Dear Lord, as your word tells us to come, to bring our joys, our concerns, our intercessory prayers with thanksgiving. We thank you that we have a God that is active. A God that desires to have a relationship with us, that cares for us even beyond our understanding. Dear Lord, there are many that are hurting. There's many that are going through difficult times. So we just lift them up to you. Minister to those that are going through treatments, those that are waiting results. Dear Lord, of the tests that they have taken. Dear Lord, I just thank you again that we're never alone. You never leave, you never forsake. In a world that really doesn't keep its promises, we have a God that does. You're the original promise keeper. There's times that we may not see your hand going on in our lives, but we can always trust your heart. So we thank you for that. I thank you for the opportunity next week for Freedom Night. I thank you for those women that had the opportunity to go to Manhattan and was truly blessed, dear Lord, for the opportunity to hear of your word. See other women, dear Lord, that are being faithful to your direction and guidance and the hope of going again next year. Also, dear Lord, for those at the Ellsworth Correctional Facility, for the men to hear about your grace, your love, your desire to have a relationship with each and every one. Dear Lord, for those that committed to follow you, to die to self and live for you, to be baptized, and for those also for recommitment, I just thank you again. Gracious God, I thank you again for our church family and continually to minister to each and every heart, that we would continually to reach out to our community, share the good news for the hope that we have, dear Lord. It is all in you, and I thank you for that. Dear Lord, just continue to work in us and work through us that we'd make a difference in our community. Also, dear Lord, come before you today. And I just ask that, dear Lord, as we come to you in the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples, that we would truly live out these words. Dear Lord, that they would change us from the inside out. As we say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us. us of trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing Praise the Lord Who Reigns Above. That's hymn number 96, or up on the screen.
Rules or regulations. Did you know that?
He wants to live in our hearts, doesn't he? And he wants us to share our hearts and our love with other people. Okay? All right. So are we ready to pray? All right. Okay, let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for loving us. And dear Jesus, we want to have to be clean on the inside, that we want to care for others. And dear Lord, that is so important. We just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. And I think the ushers have some snacks for you, all right? Yeah, all right. This time our hymn is Open the Eyes of My Heart, and you'll see that on the screen. Open the Eyes of My Heart. Such a blessing to join you. ministry. And dear Lord, we can join you in so many ways. So I also ask that you would bless not only this offering, but dear Lord, bless those that are able to give financially. Bless those that are able to give of their time and service and prayer and their presence. Dear Lord, we just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Said, honor your father and your mother, and whoever speaks evil of father or mother must surely die. But you say that if anyone tells father or mother, whatever support you might have had from me is Corban, that is, an offering to God, then you no longer permit doing anything for a father or mother, thus making void the word of God through your tradition that you have handed on, and you do many things like this. This is the word of the God, word of God for the people of God.
This time, let us go to the Lord in prayer, if you would, please, with me. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, I humbly come before you and ask that you would give me the words. Dear Lord, that they'd be your words, because your words never return void. That we'd have interpretation, application of your word for our lives. Dear Lord, I know that as not only the Pharisees and the scribes can hold on traditions and ignore your word. So, dear Lord, just reveal to us, and that our focus would be on your word for how we live, how we share. I just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. So the reading that Klein shared with us in Mark chapter 7. There were Pharisees and scribes. They came from Jerusalem to line out this Jesus. This would have been with almost 1 year before he died on the cross in Jerusalem for all our sins. We know that at this time, this would have been right after the feeding of the 5,000. And after the feeding of the 5,000, many walked away from Jesus because they wanted material needs met. They wanted, when he started talking about the kingdom and the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, they just want their kingdom for the Roman Empire to be overthrown. They even said it was a hard teaching, and many walked away. Well, now, these Pharisees, these Sadducees are coming from Jerusalem. And they knew the Old Testament very, very well. They also knew all the Jewish laws, these mandates, these traditions, that they were even following them closer than God's word. They were even trying to discredit Jesus. We see even in Mark chapter 3, verse 22, when they said Jesus' power was coming from Satan. They had blatant hypocrisy. And this passage divides into three segments. The integration of the scribes and the Pharisees and the first five verses, the indictment from 6 through 9, and the illustration from 10 through 13. So when we look at this integration, like I said, according to John 6, 4, it was right after feeding of the 5,000. This would be within a year when Jesus died on the cross. So a delegation of Pharisees and scribes came from Jerusalem. You know, it's okay, we haven't really taken away from Jesus. Many are still looking towards Jesus. Let's get the big guns. Let's get the ones from Jerusalem to come and put him in line because they even noticed Jesus' own disciples wasn't going through the process of the ceremonial washing. You see, what that consists of was just a little bit more than an egg, about 1/3 egg of water out of this cup. They would pour on the fingertips, and it would go down to their elbows until it drip dried, and then they would go the other way and pour it on their elbow and go down to their fingertips. Especially when they came from the marketplace, because someone might bump into a Samaritan or a Gentile or maybe an unclean Jewish person. So before they ate, they had to do the ceremonial washing. Now, from Scripture, this was only really for the priest. But the Pharisees, the sect of religious people, were saying all the Jewish people had to do this. And they were quite upset because Jesus, this, as they looked at as a teacher, why wasn't he having his own disciples follow this? This was so important to them. They couldn't believe that he wouldn't follow these rules, regulations, because, you see, they took the Ten Commandments and made 613 laws, and how they got that number was each alphabet in the Hebrew of the Ten Commandments would add up to 613. So they had these rules, these regulations. They were weighting people down with them. They wanted them to follow them. They also wanted to lift up themselves and tear down others. And so they wanted to discredit Jesus. Look, he's not following our ways. He's not following these traditions, and either as a disciple, he's not teaching them what they need to do. Well, that was the interrogation, to bring that up. You don't need to follow this man. He's not following our ways. So what do we see next? Well, in verses 6-9, Jesus answers them with indictment. He goes to Scripture, not to their rules or regulations, but he goes to the Word of God. And it's just like Isaiah said, you are following me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. Your hearts are far from the Lord. Much like I was telling the kids, I think about that cup. One time I was going to do a children's time before I was a pastor, so I may not have had the correct discernment, so Betty told me no. But I was going to, our youngest daughter loved chewing sunflower seeds, and the cup that she had was a nice cup, but she had spit into it. And, well, if you've seen anyone eat sunflower seeds, it's not real attractive, and I was going to show that to the kids because I was going to bring a cup that they would like of a team that they were very happy with, and then would you drink out of that? And they go, yeah, and then I was going to show that. Betty said, Dennis, leave that at home. You know, I have the Holy Spirit, and many times I don't hear the Spirit, so then Betty corrects me. Thank you, Betty. Well, I don't have to be real good today because I get to eat after this. We have a covered dish dinner. But there is supper, so I'll have to try to straighten up. But Jesus is letting them know it's about a relationship. It's about their heart. You know, they wanted to be recognized. When we look at the Sermon on the Mount, and there's many other places, they wanted to be recognized when it came to praying
They would go on the street corner and pray these big, long prayers to be recognized. I had the opportunity to witness that on a 747. We were flying to Tel Aviv from New York City. And at a certain time, there was about four men that got up, and they had their prayer, put on their prayer shawls with the long tassels, and they were going back and forth and praying so everyone could hear them, so everyone could see them. And also, it was about even when they helped the poor, they wanted to be recognized, or when they were actually even fasting, they would put on actually burlap and then a sackcloth and then put ashes over the head and not clean up. And, oh, whoa, look at me, I am fasting. But it was all about being seen. It was all about being seen. So the indictment, he let them know, you need to go to God's word. It's not about rules or regulations. And then, so then he goes to an illustration. But before I go to the illustration, it makes me think of a story that many of you have heard, but you're going to get the opportunity to hear it again. I'm going to come out here, Murray. And it was about a man that was flying. And he got to just landed, and he knew he'd only have a little time. He had to go from one concourse to the other, but he didn't have a watch. And he didn't just want to bother anyone. And he noticed this guy carrying two great big old suitcases going quite slowly. And he said, sir, do you have the time? And the gentleman said, yes, it'd just be a moment. He laid down, put down the suitcases. And then he looked at his watch. He said, Central Standard Time is this. But Tokyo time is this, New York is this, LA is this, and actually the Dow Jones is going to do this today, and also this is the kind of the weather. He just had a plethora of information. The man said, I got to have that watch. He said, oh, no, no, it's a family heirloom. I can't let you have this watch. He took out his checkbook. He said, how about $10,000? He said, here, let me give you the watch. So he gave him the watch, and then he started to run down so he could go to the next concourse to catch his flight. But all of a sudden he heard this word, wait a minute, wait a minute, you forgot your battery packs. Okay, now what does that mean, or what am I trying to go with that? When a scribe, a lawyer, tried to trick Jesus, just what is the most important law? He wasn't just talking about the Ten Commandments. He's also talking about those other 613 rules and regulations, the laws that were man-made. And Jesus said the most important is love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and strength. And the second is much like the first. Love thy neighbor as thyself. You know, in church, many times we'll put on different things that we say it's simple and that's what you need to do, but before you know it, we put on different laws and different things. You need to do this and you need to do that. You know, it's true. I've seen it. I had the opportunity to be with about 90 men that were incarcerated the last 2 days, and then getting to share God's word with them. I had the opportunity to share about prevenient grace, justifying grace, and sanctifying grace, about what Christ has done for us, to explain it to them, and then also talk about forgiveness. Having the opportunity to counsel about 10 men and hear their stories and let them know how much God loves them. Not to put a whole bunch of rules and regulations, but it is the matter of the heart. It is the matter of the heart. You see what was going on. Jesus also looked at them and told these Pharisees and these scribes, this
Klein read to us, and starting in verse 10. For Moses said, honor your father and mother. And anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. He was taking that from Exodus chapter 20 and 21. But you say that if anyone declares that what might have been used to help their father or mother is korban, that is devoted to God, then you no longer let them do anything for you no longer let them do anything for their father or mother. Thus you nullify the word of God by the traditions that you have handed down, and you do many things like that. You see, the korban was to go to God, but yet you didn't have to take it that day. It could even maybe be a year later, what many times it never was even done. But if mom and dad needed some help, because we are to honor parents for all their lives, they was using the korban so they didn't have to help them. Many times the families, their parents would even live with them. I mean, this is way before Social Security. I know it was. I can prove that. But they were using this man-made tradition. So they weren't even following God's word, God's way. Can you imagine when the people heard that? They probably think, but this is what the Pharisees, this is what the scribes, this is what the Sanhedrin is telling us. What Jesus was saying, it's about your heart. It's about following God's words. Not just with your lips, but with your hearts. With our hearts. And then when I think about that story I told, and then what Jesus said, to love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and secondly, is much like the first, I love thy neighbor as thyself. You know, when I said about traditions, I have to admit the very first time that I did a funeral when I was full-time pastor, I came from Methodist churches and other churches, and not only are you supposed to go back for seconds, but many times for thirds, and we'll try that out here in a little bit. And I didn't know any better. I didn't know what the tradition was in Protection, Kansas. I said, please come back. There's still plenty of food. Please come back. Well, one of the women that was in charge of the funeral dinner was also my secretary of that church. She says, come here, I want to talk to you. And usually when someone says that, and, oh, you did such a wonderful job, and thank you for the prayer. And no, that wasn't what she wanted to tell me. So I went in the kitchen with her. I followed her. Like all good pastors, you follow what the secretary tells you. Okay. I thought I'd get an amen. I didn't know. Anyway, we'll pray. Okay. But but anyway, she says, I want you to know that I count out each piece of ham. And if you have them come back for seconds or thirds, my women will not be able to eat. So I learned from that. So every time I had a funeral dinner, I'd say there was 10 more people than what the family told me, so people could go back for seconds. Sharon, I haven't done that to you, because you guys take care of that. But anyway, I thought it was, well, it took me back, but I learned from it. But there can be many traditions. But the most important thing is, what does God's word say? How are we to live? How are we to love? How is, because God wants to use us. I thought it was wonderful when Alice was talking about
Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 42, what they were talking about, listening to God's word and applying and praying, and what a blessing that was for them. Comes right out of Acts chapter 2. You know, we are to be God's people. This word is to change your life. And it will. And it does. It's a process. And what a blessing it is. And that we would reach out and make a difference in our community. Not with just rules or regulations, but with God's word. So at this time, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, when we look at what was going on, how there were men trying to discredit what Jesus was doing, what Jesus came to do, and they wanted to put their tradition, their man-made laws above your word and what Jesus said to them. And then pointed out how they were using their laws, their regulations to even trump and go above your word. So dear Lord, I pray that we wouldn't put anything above your word, that we'd follow your word, that we'd live out your word by what we say and by what we do. I thank you again for this time, for this opportunity. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing, I Want a Principle Within, number 410. Number but also a prayer for the meal that we'll have here in just a few minutes. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, I just thank you again for your word. And dear Lord, as it reminds us not to just serve you, you can go ahead and walk out with your lips. But dear Lord, that it would change our hearts, that we would live for you, that we love for you and love your people. I just thank you and praise you for that. And also, gracious God, I just ask that you would bless the food that has been prepared. Bless the hands that prepared it. And dear Lord, that it would not only fulfill us, but not only that, but dear Lord, that it would minister to our hearts, our mind, our body, and our souls. And I thank you again. And I send them out in your power. Power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.